So far, we have seen, in the lobby at a silent film festival, an unscheduled diversion. The tramp was a Riddler. What the blazes was his game? He was after a role, a tasty payroll. But this role had a twist, a crooked crew behind a movie camera. And two stars who didn't know they were in the picture. A trap. Caught again on film. And in the abandoned cutting room of a bankrupt movie studio, the Riddler and his felonious filmsters enjoyed the show and got ready for an even stranger one. Temper tonic poured into innocent lemonade at Mr. Van Jones's temperance party. Incredible effect. Friends turn into snarling beasts. A free-for-all. And down in the driveway, a damsel in distress. Oh, yeah? Robin. Where's Robin? In the Riddler's filthy clutches. Kindling for the biting buzzsaw. We warned you before. We warn you again. In just 1 minute, you will see a boy wonder sawed in two.
Welcome back, citizens, to an all-new episode of the Batcave Podcast. It's your old bat chum here, John S. Drew, and we are back once again with a new episode of the Batcave Podcast, and we're looking at the Riddler again. He's back for a fourth try at stumping Batman with his riddles, but it's also his last try in the form of Frank Gorshin for some time to come. The episodes we're going to be looking at is Death in Slow Motion and The Riddler's False Notion. These aired on the ABC network April 27th and 28th of 1966. Really quick synopsis. The theme for the Riddler's crimes this time around is movies, silent movies in particular. But can the type of movies the Riddler is making tell Batman more than the actual riddles the Riddler provides for the crime? Well, helping me to discuss this is a new name here to the Batcave podcast, but certainly not a new name to the Batman pantheon, the Batman mythos, in terms of writing, editing, contributing to the Gotham City 14 Miles collection of essays. His name is Mr. Bob Greenberger. Welcome to the podcast, Bob.
Hey, John. Really glad to be a part of it. I've been enjoying what I've been hearing so far.
Oh, cool. Thank you. You know, it's funny because I just posted this morning how I was going to be doing this in another episode and how we're getting to the end of the first season. And I was saying to myself, I'm kind of surprised I actually made it because there was that little part of me that said, maybe this isn't going to last. I might get bored or maybe I'm not going to get enough interest in it because we're talking the 60s Batman. And I see always a lot of negativity when it comes to this show, that it doomed Batman. And as we've discussed in the past with other people here, that 60s show was actually emulating a lot of what was going on in the comic books at the time.
It's really a split opinion here, because what you've got is, today you got a lot of people looking at the TV show through nostalgia, like me, I grew up with it. People discovered it in first run syndication. But really, the comics almost had to stop their evolution under Julie Schwartz to emulate the TV show because of its insane popularity, which caught everyone by surprise.
Now, there were a lot of elements that the TV show took from the comic book, but are you familiar with this? How many elements from the TV show, I mean, besides the pop culture and the more, you know, crazy colors and angles and such, but what other elements from the TV show got moved over to the comic book? Do you know?
Well, they certainly brought Alfred back from the dead, specifically because of his role on the TV show. They added in a mad Harriet. So a couple of things like that. The bat phone, certainly.
Oh, that really wasn't an element from beforehand.
No, sir. There was the bat signal, and they just jumped in the car and drove off.
Wow. Okay, that I didn't know. I've read very few of the early comics.
And, of course, these days, starting in the late 60s, people started drawing in the Shakespeare bust, even though there were no bat poles. But, you know, little visual tips like that.
So
certainly the Batmobile began to look more like the George Barris vehicle.
Well, it went that way definitely in the Super Friends cartoons.
Yeah, but if you take a look, in 1964, before the TV show started, but Julie had begun the new look, the really almost tank-like sized Batmobile was streamed down to what was basically a sports car. But by 1968, if you look in some of the detective covers, it's as close to the George Barris vehicle as you can get without the red striping.
A lot of this I keep meaning to like get into this is reading the older, you know, and when I say older, I mean 40s and 50s Batman. I've read, you know, an odd issue here and there, but never anything in any sort of succession to get a feel for what it was like back then.
Well, fortunately, a lot of that stuff, I mean, like certainly the first 4, 5, 6 years have already been collected in black and white in the Showcase Presents volumes. So it's fortunately affordably available.
Okay, I'll definitely have to look into that. Now, this is an episode that was inspired by one of the issues of Batman, but oddly enough, it's not even a Riddler issue because the Riddler didn't appear very much in the comics prior to the TV series.
He had previously appeared in one story in the late 40s and didn't get resurrected until just in time for the TV show. Julie found him. Julie was always a plot-driven editor, and the idea of a guy compelled to leave riddles was irresistible to him, so he brought the character back, and it was that cover, 171, that legend has it, Dozier picked up on the newsstand.
Yeah, because I always thought it was an odd choice that you went with a villain that really wasn't that recognizable in the Batman universe at that time as your first one for the first episode, that they didn't go with Joker or Catwoman or Penguin.
I think everything stems from that issue where Batman and Robin are punching him and he's spinning around like a top. You know, that's an arresting visual and certainly lent itself easily for adaptation to television.
And managed to make him, you know, I think he was the one who had the most appearances in that first season with the four.
I believe so. That's correct. Yeah. You know, after all, the pilot and these three, clearly one, Frank Gorshin was available. Two, they liked writing for him. It all worked out well.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk about this episode now. We get, you know, the standard opening here with
a small theater inside Washington Center. Gotham City's new Palace of the Arts. Wednesday afternoon, the Silent Film Festival draws to its close.
The plot opening of a silent film festival's ending being interrupted by the Riddler dressed as Charlie Chaplin. And he's doing this whole bit that has the audience roaring and laughing.
This title is incorrect. It is not the end, but the beginning. The cue for one of the most baffling crime waves ever to confront the dynamic duo.
But the provider of the films for the Silent Film Festival is very upset by all this. And in the midst of all the laughing and all the chaos that ensues as the cops arrive, the Keystone cops, the Riddler goes into the box office and robs the box office of all the take from the festival. And, you know, the first thing I noticed as a kid, even, when I was watching this, I was impressed when I saw an African-American woman, you know, on the show, because most of my television back in the 70s, I was a first generation syndication kid watching Batman. But even still, you know, shows like $6 Million Man, shows like Happy Days and such, you know, unless I watched Good Times or All in the Family, I'd get the Jeffersons there. Most of my shows were milky white people on there.
Yeah, by 1966, television had very slowly begun to integrate African-American and Asian and Latin American characters in such inconsequential roles as the woman in the box office. But visually, it was a leap forward. And bit by bit, I mean, because that was the year it was just before Mission Impossible and Star Trek gave us black recurring characters as part of the ensemble. So this is really a precursor.
Now, also something else I liked about this scene, though, was how the Riddler, after he robs the box office, he comes outside and works the robbery, though nobody realizes it, into the bit by opening up the bag and there's all the money, and he takes the blame for what's going on because they're harassing, you know, a young woman in the bit and all, and they're all taken away by the cops. The whole time everybody's laughing and not realizing that he just robbed them, you know, robbed the money from under their noses.
It's certainly one of the more clever openings because of that integration. You don't see that like that again. That could be because the script is by a guy named Dick Carr, and these are the only two episodes he wrote for the series. But he was a veteran at this sort of stuff. Carr did a lot of drama and sitcom stuff, so he was a good writer for this sort of blend. I mean, you know, just before this, he'd been writing stuff like Peyton Place, so he certainly know how to build up to a cliffhanger. And then subsequently, you know, he must have enjoyed Batman because he then went on to write for $6 Million Man and Wonder Woman. So clearly, he brought something of himself to the story.
It's funny, though, because you mentioned Dick Carr, and he's, as you say, this was the only story he did. There were a lot of writers who only did one episodes, you know, one story arcs for Batman in the first season. I mean, you had Lorenzo Semple and I don't know if Stanley Ralph Ross, I think he had started writing by then for the show, but there weren't a lot of regular names on the show.
Well, sorry about that. My dog.
Is that Ace?
Yeah, not quite. So, basically, the show, according to the writer interviews I've read through the years, talked about how challenging it was. They didn't quite get the tone, or they didn't quite understand how to integrate the gadgets or the specific language. Great narration that Dozier himself did, or some of the superlatives that, you know, came out of Commissioner Gordon or Batman's mouths.
Well, you mentioned Dick Carr also, and I got to say this by full disclosure here, as fans of my other podcast, Cyborgs, the Bionic Podcast, knows, Dick Carr wrote one of the worst episodes also of the $6 Million Man called Lost Love, in which Steve Austin is reunited with a former lover of his long before Jamie Summers, and it is one of the worst. And I don't know how much of that is Richard Carr's doing as the writer or just the ineptness of the direction and the actors. And it's just, and of course, Lee Majors, you know, trying to emote love wasn't working too well in that particular episode. It's very painful.
No, not at all.
Yeah. But here it does work well. He does actually, and you know, without getting too far into it, I did enjoy this episode.
It worked as an episode largely because it paid homage to the silent films, which the parents of the kids watching knew something about and could appreciate. And to the kids, it was, you know, it's visual humor, which was very easily to comprehend.
Yeah, that was something else I had noted in my notes here, was that, you know, even then, still in the 60s, you know, silent films were playing on television and such. I even remember as a kid in the 70s watching silent films like on my PBS station and such. So I could appreciate it. I mean, I don't know how much today, if the series ran, how much this episode would go well with young people if they were watching the series. But back then, it was a nice homage, and I got the cues and understood who Harold Lloyd was when he's mentioned later on in the episode.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
The other silent touch here is the names of the thugs. Because
yes,
you've got CB, who is the nickname, you know, Ready When You Are CB, is a cliche from a lot of movies of the era and TV shows of the era, referring to Cecil B. DeMille.
Okay.
Classic director of silence. As well as Von Blowheim, which is a reinterpretation of the great German director Erich von Stroheim. And then, of course, you've got the gentleman providing all the films is the former silent film star, Francis X. Bushman. And Bushman was one of the few silent actors to go on to a talking film career. And this was one of his last roles before he died. And Neil Hamilton, our commissioner, was also a silent film star in his day. So this, I'm sure, brought back good memories to him.
Yeah, that was a nice touch having him there as a former silent film star, but someone who also at the same time had proven acting chops in the, you know, talkies He did have, like, quite a list of films after his silent film career.
You know, I know Hamilton took this because, you know, actors need to eat and work. And, you know, I don't think he fully appreciated what he brought to the series on a regular basis, which is why I'm really glad he got his bigger part in part two of this two-parter that he gets.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, it's so funny because I often, you know, see him in other films and such, and you wouldn't know from watching it. Like, I remember, I think it was the second Tarzan film with Johnny Weissmuller. He's in that. And you wouldn't know from looking at him that he's going to be the commissioner someday. But, you know, the earnestness that he puts into, you know, the role and such, and some of the lines that might be cringeworthy, he's able to deliver with such earnestness that you're willing to believe it when, like, he's waving away Batman and saying, you know, go save that boy. And I'm like, wow. He sells it.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's a definite gravitas to his performance as Gordon that helps ground these silly words coming out of his mouth occasionally, especially when he gets really purple in his descriptions of the, you know, malefactors who are plaguing Gotham City and only one man can save us now as he solemnly walks to the Batphone. I mean, he's great about that.
Speaking of which, you know, we get the scene where he, you know, then goes to the Batphone to alert Dick and Bruce, Batman and Robin. And we don't get a lengthy scene this time with Dick and Bruce, anything to the effect of they're playing checkers or talking about lacrosse or whatever in this case. I mean, Bruce is the one who answers the phone.
Right.
Yeah.
I can only imagine that got scripted and they figured out from a timing standpoint they just needed to keep moving.
Probably.
So they truncated this. And also by then, the visual shorthand had been established. This was the penultimate two-parter for the first season.
Right.
So, you know, I'm going to presume this was filmed in late February because it aired in April. So by then they knew the show was a smash success. So I'm going to presume that, you know, they knew they could start taking some of those shortcuts.
And unfortunately, that to me is what's going to lead to its downfall when they start to, I don't want to say take advantage of a good situation, but they shortchange everything in order to, like you say, with these shortcuts to move things along. And storytelling wise, it might work, but in some ways it cheats the audience at times. And you get a little disappointed when you see that because they're going to do it again in the next episode as well. But at least it makes more sense in the next episode because Alfred is kidnapped. So there's nobody there to answer the phone.
Well, you know, to me, you can only come up with excuses for Anne Harriet, you know, or Alfred saying, the hi-fi is acting up again. I'll go tend to it.
I always loved that one. What was the point of Dick's holy triple feature when he didn't know the caper yet? And this was the Riddler's fourth appearance.
That's true.
That's like me blurting out like right now.
Triple feature. I think you're absolutely right. I think they tipped their hand here.
Yeah. I mean, it's like me just suddenly blurting out holy watermelon. What's that? Yeah. You know, it's like, unless I'm having watermelon later on and don't realize it. But you know, it just seemed weird, that particular line. Although I did like the fact that when they were running towards the bat poles, they bumped into each other. They got mixed up.
It's an odd bit that I clearly, again, I think the schedule just didn't let them reshoot it.
Right.
They just had to keep moving.
Yeah.
I mean, these things are shot. One of the things that I notice is after the established sets, Wayne Manor, the Batcave, police headquarters and stuff, there's a cheapness to the rest of the sets that I really had not noticed growing up. But boy, you know, I know the opticals for things like the sound effects during the fights were expensive, but I don't think I realized just how flimsy looking everything else was.
It wasn't as bad in the first season, but you could see as the series went on that they would opt more for in-studio stuff with very limited backgrounds and such, and it just got cheaper and cheaper as it went along.
But even here, I mean, the box office we just talked about, you know, was pretty much a couple of walls and a cash register and, you know, not much to really tell you. It's a box office. Later when we get into some of the other settings, they're just really, you know, it's almost like impressionistic. This is what a bakery might look like.
Yeah, well, the bakery was pretty short and to the point, you know. But yeah, there wasn't much there in the way of. But then again, it's not like you need a big space for something like that in this case, because there wasn't a bat fight.
No.
Yeah.
Very true. That comes later.
Yeah. We cut to the commissioner's office, and now this is something I have a problem with the Riddler as the series progressed. When the show started, the riddles that the Riddler would give you made sense, in the sense that as a kid, even sitting there, you could solve the riddles. And then Batman and Robin would obviously solve them too. And then they would apply Gotham City Batman logic to the riddles to figure out what the crime was. And that's fine. But the part of the fun of the Riddler is, as a kid, you know the answers to the riddles. So when you get a riddle like, why is the musician stand like an oven? And you're just, and I'm like thinking, you know, baton, I'm thinking musical, I'm thinking musician stand. And you're getting, you know, your answer is because they need to make the bread. It's like, wow, you either really got to be just a real hipster with a twisted sense of humor to get that. You know, all of a sudden it loses that charm for the kids by having these, and there's a lot of them in this episode. There's a couple that work, but there's a couple that just, you know, you really got to connect the dots to get that answer.
I think the hipster, the whole thing about dough, bread, and the fact that Gordon doesn't get it.
Yes.
I think it's Carr or Dozier or Horowitz or, you know, one of the guys involved was trying to get hip and speak to, I guess, the teens and young adults who might be, have been starting to watch the show. But I blame Carr. I just don't think they were the best riddles they could have been.
No, and like I say, there was a couple more later on that worked better, but not here. So that when, you know, you get the bread is the answer, and then the bread with the payroll and the payroll to the bakery because there's still the connection. Okay, fine. But I just would have liked a riddle that I could solve first and then let Batman and Robin, you know, twist it into Gotham City logic.
I agree.
But what I do love is, though, is that, you know, for our opening scene with, you know, the Riddler in costume, the costume is the suit.
Yeah, unlike the Joker, Penguin, King Tut, Catwoman, and so on, the Riddler had multiple outfits, and it's interesting, you know, because Gorshin makes it work in, regardless of what he's wearing, and it also helps set the Riddler apart from the rest of the gang.
Yeah, it does. It does. And he looks good in the suit. I never liked, you know, the leotards, and I know he didn't either.
As an 8-year-old, I thought he was wonderful. One of the reasons when you offered me a villain to work with, I picked the Riddler, because as a kid, I loved Gorshin's performance. I thought he looked great in the leotard with the big question marks and all, and that laugh of his was just so memorable. It was one of the few things I definitely could imitate as a kid.
Real, you're one of the few, because I ask people to imitate the Riddler. I mean, the Penguin's easy, or to do a purr like Catwoman, even an attempted Joker laugh, but Riddler is just, you know, because he's so manic, it's hard. I can't do it. That's impressive that you were able to. You couldn't do it now, huh?
I would have to have warmed up before we recorded to see if I could really replicate it today. Especially these days, now that I'm in the classroom, you know, 5 performances a day.
Yes.
My voice is not as limber as it usually is.
5 performances. That's what I say, too. 5 performances. Check me daily. 5 days a week. So, we get the Riddler in the suit, and you know, they're at the bakery doing the robbery, and the Riddler points out this is a red herring, and I got nervous for a moment because I thought he was going to reveal the whole plot like he did in the last episode, because about halfway through, you know, at the cliffhanger point, he tells Batman everything, and I'm like, that's no fun. But he doesn't. He just says it's a red herring to throw them off what the real plan is. And I like that he blows open the safe, but he's no longer using the silent explosives he had in the last episode.
Right.
Yeah.
And throughout this, you notice he's got the camera rolling. It's not a real camera in use.
Yeah.
Although it mocks, or I'm sorry, it imitates the hand-cranked camera they used back in the silent days. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the one tripod, but you notice here, the guy never moves. He stands there with the camera, and he's telling the Riddler, it's in some cases, he's actually telling the Riddler what to do.
Yes.
Like, he's directing, even though it's the Riddler's caper.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And And like you say, we'll get to it in a few moments because they're going to watch the film and all of a sudden the one camera seems to have multiple angles.
I was going to mention that because that really bothered me.
Yeah, but that's a failing of most 60s and 70s television when they look back at the tapes of anything or the film of anything. Suddenly you get the director's cut.
Yes.
See, now we then get a couple of, or we actually get one riddle because, the Riddler gets away just as Batman is pulling up.
Look at that wall. Batman, as one baker to another, how do you make a dishonest shortcake?
Dishonest shortcake?
There's strawberry shortcake.
And blueberry shortcake.
A dishonest shortcake.
I've got it! A lieberry. That would make it a dishonest shortcake.
Right, Robin. Library. Clearly a corrupted version of the word library. As one baker to another.
Hey, isn't there a branch library on Baker Street?
And Aunt Harriet goes there all the time. We haven't a moment to lose. Let's race to the Batmobile.
I could see that one if you say it's because they go through this strawberry shortcake, library shortcake. Okay, library, a play. It's a stretch, but it works better than the first ones.
But it just means the entire episode is built on stretched riddles, so it's not really as well written as it could have been.
Oh, no, absolutely. Absolutely. But it does give Batman the next clue to move on to the library, where we get to see the bat key, which we'll never see again.
Yeah, breaking and entering with a skeleton key that looks like any key you could get at a hardware store really was disappointing.
But I did like how Batman is all upset over the fact that the library is closed on a Wednesday due to budget cuts.
Yeah, it's one of the rare times the municipal life is on display for people.
I'd say it was a bit more in the first season. It was something they sort of tended to forget later on. Because I do remember also where he was telling Robin to put the dime in the meter because that helps build roads and, take care of them and all that, which was also another nice little touch.
Oh, true. And, of course, they also did the seatbelt safety because that was the era when seatbelt safety under Ralph Nader was really being pushed heavily. Mm-hmm. But in this case, I would have to do some research, but I would bet there have been headlines about library budget cuts and closings, and it meant they didn't have to hire extras to fill out the set.
Oh. Yeah, that's true.
Again, it's a budget issue.
That's true. Who knows? Maybe it had even been originally scripted that there might have been the librarian in there and working in some jokes or something to that effect.
Right.
Now, they get inside the library. They open it up using the bat key. And they're immediately knocked down by this giant book.
Which I thought was hysterical as a kid. Like, where the heck did that come from? And how heavy could it be to, on the one hand, it knocks them to the ground. And on the other hand, they can pick it up and toss it away like it was papier mache.
Yeah. Yeah. And for that matter, I'd like to know how they managed to get it in the Batmobile to bring back to the Batcave.
Well, that's where the unofficial crossover with the Atom must have happened so they could use some of the white dwarf matter to shrink it down and fit.
This is when we start getting into the Dangerous, Brave, and the Bold era. with the cartoon. I shouldn't say dangerous because I actually enjoyed the cartoon. I don't know if you did, but I thought, once it got past its first couple of episodes, it was fun.
Okay, Batman the Brave and the Bold cartoon is brilliant, wonderful, fun, and one of the best versions of animated Batman you're ever going to find. Obviously, this episode aired before the Brave and the Bold became a permanent Batman team-up book. I have no idea how they covered the book getting into the Batcave. Hmm.
The trunk couldn't fit it, and there's not, unless Robin held it on his lap as they were driving back.
Or they placed a call to the van that picks up the parachutes and said, hey, guys, I'll need you to pick up my parachutes. Can you pick up this book and, deliver it for me?
There you go.
Again, that was one of those weird moments that, that's all these guys do, 24/7, wait for the parachutes to be deployed.
Being on call. Hey, they were getting paid well by Bruce Wayne without realizing
it. One of the loneliest jobs I can imagine.
Now, we get to that scene, and we talked about this briefly just before. We get to the scene with Riddler watching, the scenes that have already been shot on film. And
yeah, absolutely no time to develop or edit.
Nope.
Just plays it on a projector.
Plays it on a projector, and we see multiple angles in the bakery.
Yeah.
You know, we basically get the same footage we just saw as the viewers. And yet, oddly enough, the Batmobile approach to the bakery scene is shot like it was from the camera from the truck. So I don't understand. If they went out of their way to do another approach take, why couldn't they do the same thing and have a one-camera shot, you know, just following Riddler as he moves through, you know? Why couldn't they do that?
Bad storytelling is the only answer I can really offer you. But, you know, the other thing I found fascinating here is the concept of pies with the knockout whipped cream.
Yes.
Because, I mean, you know, whoever invented that, I mean, you know, there are all these really intriguing inventions the villains use that if they actually patented it and sold it, wouldn't need to commit crimes.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. But then, you know, I think he even actually addressed that once, Batman, or once or twice in the series. Like, if only he could use his mind on doing things like this for good, what, you know.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Not here, though.
No, not here. No, not at all. And we also get a little bit of, I would say, the Riddler's immaturity and, of course, his manicness as, you know, he playfully plays the scene of the book dropping on top of Batman and Robin, you know, going back and forth and having it rise and hit him again on the head.
Again, that's one of the things that makes the Riddler stand out as a villain. He is manic. He takes such delight in his capers and confounding the Caped Crusader. I think it has less to do with the money than the sheer joy of it. Because, you know, the Penguin is out for money and power. The Joker is really out to beat Batman and also get rich. Catwoman is about the crimes and the cat objects. King Tut just wants to bring Egypt back. But the Riddler really, he's set apart. He is out for matching wits and having a great time doing it. I think that's why he's got the multiple costumes. I think that's why he takes delight in rewatching Batman's fall here. And I'm probably applying far more psychology than the producers did.
Well, you may be doing that than what the producers did, but there are, you know, moments, and including in the Batman movie, where the Riddler points out that, you know, it's just not worth it if he can't do the riddles, if he can't outwit Batman, if he can't have the fun of this. That's part of the whole thrill of being who he is and what he
does.
Yeah,
I mean, it's not, no one questions him this episode, but there are other appearances where they say, why do you keep leaving clues?
Yeah. And speaking of the clues, there's the two clues in the book that fall on Batman and Robin. They're back at the Batcave. And again, it's a mix. One riddle makes no sense. I mean, because who could figure out what is found in a kitchen cabinet that is not alive and come up with deadpans? It's where you're trying to come up with a riddle that's crafted to the caper specifically, and you're actually, yeah, you're inventing a riddle. But mind you, I did like the other one of, when is a car considered seedy? Because that kind of, you know, think about lemons and cars, and lemons have seeds. That works to a certain extent.
Yes.
To a certain extent.
Yeah, I mean, certainly better than most of the others we've covered so far.
Yeah, yeah. And, of course, Batman deduces that, you know, it's for the party that the silent film collector, I can't remember his name now for a moment there. Why am I blanking on his name?
Van Jones.
Van Jones, there you go.
Which is a fairly generic name.
Right, right.
It doesn't inform the character. It's just the name.
Right. Batman figures out about Van Jones's party, where it's a temperance party. He's going to be just serving lemonade, thus the lemons from the seedy car and such. And he and Robin race to the house, but he arrives too late. The party is already getting ugly.
Maury Whittle's better than Honus Wagner.
50 times better.
You're an ignorant oaf, Chief O'Hara. I wonder why I keep you in my department.
Your Royal Highness? Often I've wondered why I don't resign. Oops.
You clumsy brute. Did you bump into me on purpose?
I'm sorry. Terribly.
I didn't think Batman was on your guest list, Mr. Van Jones.
Considering these louts who were, dearie, I'd say that's entirely in his favor.
Sour lemonade, Van Jones.
You don't like it, London.
Personally, I think it's unusually sweet.
The boors a man in my position has to tolerate. Is it worth it? Yeah.
Batman to Batmobile.
All quiet here, Batman. Any sign of the Riddler?
Not a trace, Robin. But there's something strange going on here. Everyone seems to be in the most incredibly bad temper.
It's pink.
In fact...
Say that once again, stupid. Your dress is pink, colorblind.
I'll call you back.
And in one of the best scenes in this whole episode, there's Gordon and O'Hara, and their exchange is something I'd expect them to actually say one day to each other, in a way. Because here's Gordon, who is this great commissioner. He's got, you know, and he has to deal with people like O'Hara, who can be a bit bumbling at times. And then you've got O'Hara, who's probably, you know, there are times probably where Gordon has said things to him that he wishes he could snap back at him, but knows he can't because he's the boss.
Yeah, it's good to have them there. It's a good use of the supporting cast. This party scene clearly took the place of one of the traditional Batman fights and is comic in its silliness as the spiked lemonade drives everyone to aggressive behavior. And we've got all these senior citizens smacking each other, pillows and bumbling fisticuffs. It's very, you know,
it's very reminiscent of a silent film.
Yes, exactly what I was about to say.
Yeah. And only in Gotham would a woman dressed up as Little Bo Peep fail to be considered odd by Robin.
Yes.
If a woman walked up to you like that or any other place in the world, you'd have to sort of like, you know, what's going on? But here, Robin's let me help you, ma'am.
If somebody walked up to me like that today, I'd try and wonder where the cosplay convention is. But back then, you know, if I were Robin, I'd be, you know, checking out Bo Peep's legs. I mean, Sherry Jackson, and again, this was shot February, so this is a good 6 months before she shot her Star Trek episode we remember her for.
Yes.
You know, she was quite the, not ingenue, but she was certainly an attractive actress of her day.
Oh, yeah, very attractive. I mean, that first outfit she's wearing in the... Well, not the first one, but in the bakery scene where she's the poor woman looking for food and such for the family. I was like, wow, you know, that she looked great in that.
And I also like the fact, since we're backtracking a moment, the fact that the Riddler has her rehearsing.
Yes.
Because it's one of the rare times you see the criminals actually preparing their plan.
Yes. It was a nice touch.
Yeah.
You know, once again, Batman loses Robin to the Riddler.
It's the damsel in distress of traditional cliffhanger storytelling. It's also, you know, maybe there's a little something between the Riddler and Robin that dare not speak its name.
You know, I wonder about that, because Robin seems to be a bit more intense around the Riddler than he is of many of the other villains.
Well, I'm just thinking, if I had Jill St. John, I wouldn't be kidnapping the Robin.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. But it leads up nicely, and like you said, right in, you know, silent film peril fashion there, with Robin on the conveyor belt moving towards a buzzsaw with the cameras rolling on him.
After many gassers, here's the real buzzer. Is Robin going to wind up as his own double? Incredible but true. Batman will not arrive in time. Will we see the boy wonder sawed in two? Tune in tomorrow. Same bat time, same bat channel.
Which is such a perfect cliffhanger simply because it is exactly what the silent films Perils of Pauline, the first serialized storytelling on film, really embodied. You know, it could have been a train track, could have been the buzzsaw. It's so wonderful. It also, you know, the buzzsaw thing, it was done with I think it was Jimmy Olsen in an episode of Superman in the 50s. So, you know, it's one of those great cliche cliffhangers you want.
What's funny is, and I mentioned it before, and as this now second episode develops, we're seeing more of the same beats. This episode very much resembles the very first episode, because even when we come back from the cliffhanger, we don't linger on Robin for very long, you know, with the conveyor belt and such. Instead, we cut to Batman coming out of the party, knowing Robin's gone. He's got to go find him and all. And I love the line from, you know, him where he's talking to Gordon, who's apologizing for his behavior.
I'm so ashamed, Batman, the way I behaved at that party.
It's not your fault, Commissioner. Riddler's henchmen spiked your drinks with tempered tonic. Now that you've taken my universal drug antidote, you'll be all right.
Yes, but still, my unseemly behavior certainly contributed toward Robin's capture.
Let that be a lesson. In future, be more careful from whom you accept free lemonade.
Yeah, you know, those cautionary comments are always, you know, you want to say something snarky in response because, yes, you always suspect the lemonade.
You always suspect. But you know, he says it, and we're at this point in the series where he is still so sincere. He's not in on the joke yet, Adam West. He's letting himself be the joke. And so he says it so sincerely that you're okay with it.
If you think about it, the show was shot in February, was written earlier in the month, possibly as late as late January or as early as late January, which means that Carr probably had the pilot to work with and little else, which may be why the structure is parallel.
Ooh, that's an interesting thought. You're probably right. You're probably right about that. I didn't even think about that, but that makes sense because this was also a short season.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, the pilot was shot in 65 and was rushed into production. My guess, shot in October, if memory serves, which means they got the green light and got rushed onto the air for the ABC second season promotion. So, yeah, I mean, there was very little to go on. And it was all being done in a rush to make these new air dates.
And it's funny, too, because, you know, I mean, like you say, it beat for beat. I mean, we get Batman figuring out based on some new riddles that Robin's at the lumberyard. He gets to the lumberyard and there's the Riddler and he thinks he's going to snag the Riddler, but he sees Robin on the conveyor belt, gets down there, and it's a dummy, a mannequin.
Which is a great fake. As opposed to coming out with, you know, some sort of bat rust spray or something to stop the blade.
Oh, absolutely. But in a way, it's kind of like the first episode in a way, too, because Robin really wasn't ever in any peril, as he also wasn't in the first episode.
Oh, very true.
You know, I mean, it looked horrific. Oh, my God, they're putting the vice grip on his head, and what's Riddler going to... But it was just, no, I'm just getting your measurements. Hang on, you know.
Very clever.
Yeah. Although, now, see, this is the big problem I have with the episode, because I did like Sherry Jackson so much. I liked her character of Pauline. I thought she looked great and everything. But she kind of gets shortchanged here because she's caught, and she's not going to be on, you know, screen for much longer after this.
She totally vanishes in the second half.
Yeah.
And it's a real shame, and, you know, no poor deluded girl or her coming on to Batman. I mean, none of those usual tropes are there.
No, she doesn't get any chance of redemption as a lot of the moles do get. Although we do get, just like in the first episode, he brings her back to the Batcave. I mean, this time willingly, knowingly, unlike with... Well, actually, he did know, too. He realized it very quickly that that wasn't Robin, with Jill St. John dressed up as Robin. But still...
Well, how could you not? So anyway, you know, the interesting thing here is looking at the structure of the second episode, that whole bringing her to the Batcave and Gordon and all of that, while a great moment for Neil Hamilton, is padded.
Great Scott! At last, the fabulous Batcave!
Unusual, isn't it?
Oh, magnificent! I feel as if I've awakened in some future age. Such equipment! What fantastic ingenuity you and the boy Wonder have employed in hooking it together.
True. We did muster many long hours of brain power. However, this is no time for self-congratulation. A small demonstration will now take place.
A demonstration?
Yes, Commissioner. Take this can of Batwake. When I give you this signal, spray a whiff of it in the prisoner's face.
Certainly.
Oh, yeah.
I think they had pacing trouble. I really think Carr had some scripting issues here, because first episode moves along like a typical Batman episode. Second episode, the pacing is long and prolonged.
You will notice, Commissioner, that this bat mask in most ways resembles an ordinary operating room oxygen mask. I will introduce no drugs, no serums into Pauline's bloodstream.
I understand.
Now, Commissioner, give her the bat wake, please.
Oh, yes.
Until you get the final fight scene, which is a truncated version of their usual fight scenes. So,
where am I?
Deep in the entrails of the earth, Pauline, where every instrument has been designed to combat crime and snare its perpetrators.
There are those who came to this Batcave and never left.
That is true.
To me, I'm smelling that they had some production trouble.
Oh, I agree with you. Absolutely. I mean, you know, it's cool to see the commissioner there. It's great for Hamilton. He gets a chance to be on the set and all that and actually, you know, act on it and all. And it's also very, like, melodramatic with, you know, Batman going, you know, we are deep within the, you know, the thing. And Gordon going along going, yes, some have never returned. And I'm like, yeah, Jill St. John never returned.
Hamilton plays it well, the solemnity, the honor of being invited to the Batcave.
Yes.
The opportunity to look around, and Batman not saying anything to him like, you know, there may be clues to my secret identity, Commissioner. Don't look.
Yes.
You know, things like that. So he looks around in wonder and amazement. And the whole reason for his being there is to be credible witness to this extraction of detail from Sherry Jackson.
Yeah.
You know, with that whole, you know, airliner gas mask thing.
It's his own unique way of truth detection.
Yeah. And it's a clever bit of business. It's just, again, it's a prolonged scene that doesn't feel right in the general pacing of the series.
No. And then, oddly enough, we don't even get a scene with him or even like something to the effect of, all right, I'll bring you back. He says, I'm going to leave you on the side of the road because he's got to move and get to Robin. Obviously, I'm going to leave you and Pauline on the side of the road asleep with the bat gas waiting for Chief O'Hara to wake you up.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, he's the police commissioner. He probably could call a patrol car to pick him up, you know? Yeah,
exactly. I mean,
I think, again, they just didn't think it through.
Well, my first thought also was that if anybody driving by on the roadside, if this were today and saw a woman, you know, lying next to police Commissioner Gordon on the side of the road, there'd be pictures. It'd be all over the internet.
Yes, but obviously back then that didn't happen.
No.
But again, you know, putting them to sleep, using the bad wake, you know, tucked in his coat pocket, you know, it's sort of simplistic, kind of sweet. And gets him out of the story. And that's really the last we see of her.
Yeah, that's it. She's done now. And I mean, we still have another good, I'd say, what, 10 minutes to go before the episode's over. And she's out of the show altogether.
Yes.
Yeah.
And clearly you and I would have done it differently.
Oh, yeah. No. Well, especially with someone of Sherry Jackson's stature. I mean, at that point in her career, she'd appeared in enough television and movies that it was worth having her there. You know, you brought her in, you utilize her more effectively.
Yes, absolutely. They just moved the story along.
Yeah.
And so now Batman's got this information. He's got to act on it.
Exactly. And you know, he knows that it's, you know, Riddler's going to do something with Robin at the top of the building based on the riddles that, you know, the information he gets from Pauline and such. And all right, this, it's odd. It's a stretch. But there's Riddler near the roof, and he's got Robin tied up, and the hands are bound, and all, and Batman is at the top, and he pushes Robin off the building, and Batman is able to call out to him as he's falling rapidly, quick, grab the batarang with your teeth.
Yeah, that is definitely one of the most implausible moments in the first season.
Yes.
Although we do get that valuable public service message.
You all right, Robin?
Holy molars. Am I ever glad I take good care of my teeth.
True. You owe your life to dental hygiene.
But, yes, I mean, you know, Burt Ward plummeting down. It was an interesting dilemma. The idea of catching with your teeth just really strikes me as weak.
Well, yeah, but there wasn't any other way he could have done it. Really?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, unless he like was falling in such a way that he could grab it with the back of his, you know, from with his hands tied behind his back with his hands sort of gripping out or something like that. But it just, there was no way around it. It was the most absurd thing, but it was the most plausible out of what he had to work with, I guess.
arguably there were a couple, you know, you could probably sit and think of a couple of options to get around it. But yeah, I mean, it just is what it is.
Yeah. Yeah. And we get more riddles, which, you know, it appears that the dynamic duo are being duped by them because they think that it's the Riddler's final target is the L Chief train, a train for silent movie stars, and that the Riddler's going to rob it and such. So, you know, they call in Chief O'Hara and tell him to, you know, surround the train and make sure the Riddler doesn't get in there. And we think that's going to be it, but we switch and we see the Riddler with Van Jones delivering the final print of the film he's made for him. And as Van Jones is going to pack it away in his safe with all the other silent films, the Riddler pulls out his gun and reveals his real plan.
Mr. Van Jones, why are you like a clock at midnight? Answer. Because both your hands are going straight up right now.
What is this?
This is your last reel. Step aside.
But my film! You can't take them. They're priceless.
I think we'll find a price when you try to ransom them back. This way, partners!
No sheriff for the baby.
Posse went that away to the train station. Hurry it up, boys. Clean out that safe and let's head for them hills.
Blazes?
A bad shadow.
Same old ending, Riddler. It never fails.
Thought you had his fool with your double-dealing clues, huh?
The Great Train Holdup. The most famous silent film ever made. And the only existing print is right here in the Van Jones safe.
Get him, boys. Get him or we'll never make it to the border.
First of all, the idea that Van Jones was behind this was a nice touch. The fact that he would, although one wonders why you would possibly trust a criminal to making a movie and not suspect you might be double-crossed.
Well, that was a fairly common theme in a lot of the episodes there where the villain managed to get the trust of someone, whether it was, you know, Dr. Somnambula with J. Pauline Spaghetti. You know, he was trying to help her sleep, and even though he was a known criminal.
True, but Jones went to the Riddler.
Call Chief O'Hara, Robin. Tell him we have the entire cast right here.
The cast?
You're about to star in a picture of your very own, Riddler. A long picture. Title, Up the River.
He didn't get seduced.
That's true. That's true. You got a point there. You got a point there. But again, this is just like the first episode, though, because Batman and Robin, you know, it looks like they figured out the clues wrong. They're off to someplace else. But Batman figures out that, you know, the real thing is at the embassy with the elephant and all, with the stamps inside. It's the same thing here. Batman figures out, no, it's not the train. It's Van Jones' home and his collection. So they're waiting in the safe.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
And we get that bat fight scene, like you said, and it is abbreviated.
It's an abbreviated fight. And again, unlike that sumptuous set with the elephant, this one is just, you know, plain, you know, pastel walls and no real sense of place.
No. And it's dark, too. It's not a little very bit well lit.
It was the screening room, the vault. You know, I could see that. But it's also one of the last times Batman does the silhouette.
Yes. It's one of the last times he does the silhouette. I will say, though, I did like, I don't know why, I found it funny, was, you know, sort of the way to end the scene is Robin hopping up on top of the fireplace there. And as Batman slugs each one towards him, he gives him a final bonk on the head to knock him out.
Yeah, teamwork. And slightly different choreography than usual. So it was fine. Mm-hmm. Short, but fine.
Short, but fine. Exactly. And of course, we get, you know, one final, you know, line from Batman telling Riddler he's in his next film called Up the River. In Adam West's, you know, perfect, stilted, you know, let me get each word out so that, you know, I have as much screen time as possible.
Yep. And then, you know, then we have this odd coda. That has nothing to do with the case.
Has nothing to do with the case, but then again, that's because we didn't have anything at the beginning to tie with the end. You know? So, I mean, and I would imagine that in syndication, although I don't remember, to be honest with you, as a kid, this probably got cut first. You know, because you could just end it right there, go to credits with, you know, after the bat fight, it's over. Because again, like you say, it has nothing to do with the episode. It's cute. You know, I mean, it's...
My guess is at some point the script was written and Harry Horowitz and William Dozier basically said, well, there's nothing for, you know, Aunt Harriet to do this week.
Mm-hmm. So let's
so they added that. This.
Yeah.
So they added that scene earlier in the episode with Harriet and Alfred. And then the coda, you know, the surprise visit.
Yes. Yeah. It's a cute scene.
And it was a sweet little scene, but it just felt so out of left field.
Absolutely. But then, like I said, that's the first thing you cut then in syndication because it doesn't affect the flow of the story in any way. But for Frank Gorshin's last turn until the third season, you know, it's kind of a shame that in many respects he's doing this. The story follows the same beats, even if it's a different theme or plot to it. It still has the same beats as the first episode. And it's interesting because Gorshin, you know, in doing this episode, you'd think he might have caught on or something because I read somewhere, and I can't remember where it was, that Gorshin never intended to do more than the pilot. He was not one of these guys who wanted to keep coming back like Cesar Romero and Burgess Meredith because he felt that you couldn't do much with the character. So he had a guarantee from the producers that there would always be something unique about his appearances if he was going to do this. And they managed to, for the most part, you know, through his four episodes, but this one does have similar beats to the first one, and yet he did it.
Yep. So there were 17 weeks of Batman in the first season. He was in four of them. Mm-hmm. So, but, you know, that's literally a quarter of the first season, which really is one reason he made such an indelible impression through the repetition. But, yeah, I mean, you know, Gorshin definitely had to be coaxed. It's why he held out after the first season of the movie not to appear in the second season. They kept rewriting parts for other characters like the Puzzler, until finally they gave in and gave it to John Astin, who gave it such a very different performance, which is why they basically begged Gorshin to come back for the third season for the one episode appearance.
If Astin had been the Riddler from the get-go, I guess I would have been fine with it. I mean, I don't know. I mean, there was nothing wrong with his performance. It's just that wasn't the Riddler.
No, Astin's was a very laconic performance, a far more cerebral approach to parrying with Batman, whereas Gorshin just gave us this manicness, the laughter, the jumping up and down, you know, the fists pumping and excitement controlled. You know, I mean, he it was just such an energetic performance that Astin just felt flat.
Yeah, he did.
I give the producers credit for trying. I guess they couldn't find any performer to be as close to Gorshin, so they went vastly differently with Astin.
Is it that they went different, or that Astin, that's just the way he chose to? I mean, because he can do manic in his own way, not the kind of manic as Gorshin does. I mean, because he was Gomez, for God's sakes.
Well, that's just it. I'm wondering if his approach to this was, since this was one of his first guest roles after the Addams Family had been canceled, that Astin was definitely trying to distance himself from playing Gomez.
Possibly. And then figuring this is the Riddler, a man who engages in mind, you know, games and stuff and puzzles. He, you know, played him up as being very, as you said, cerebral.
Yep.
Yeah. We talked about Sherry Jackson. I just have a note here that I guess I'm on a Sherry Jackson kick this week because between recording this episode, I did watch What Are Little Girls Made Of earlier in the week. It wasn't anything I planned. I just happened to watch it. And then last night I watched The Twilight Zone's The Last Rites of Jeff Myrtleback.
Ah.
And she was on there as well. So
interesting.
It's just one of those, you know, moments of serendipity, I guess, or synchronicity that all coming together with Sherry Jackson.
Well, I think of her often because there's a book out now called These Are the Voyages, which is about the history of Star Trek. And it's being heavily promoted on Facebook ads. And one of the pictures they use to promote it is a shot of Shatner and Sherry Jackson on top of that turntable disco dancing.
I seem to remember that from the blooper reels as well.
Yes.
Yeah.
She was a fun actress.
She was. Her birthday's coming up soon because I know I've seen some people on Facebook commenting about liking her Facebook page there and trying to get it up to a certain number of likes before birthday. So I'll put a link up for that in the show notes when we release this episode.
So, okay, cool. So looking at the guest cast for the two-part episode, other than Sherry Jackson and Francis X. Bushman, the rest of these guys, the performers, the men and the women, you know, really never amounted to anything memorable like Sherry Jackson did. So I'm not sure if it was just an availability thing or they really spent the money on Jackson and Bushman.
Some of that could be, I mean, because that's happened in episodes past, including, you know, the one with Malachi Throne is False Face, because they also had, now I can't remember her name, who played Blaze. And they actually were paying her more money than they were Malachi Throne.
Oh, I did not know that.
Yeah. So that's why he kind of was like, well, if you're going to do that, then let's really give them, you know, because I'm not doing much to begin with. And now you're not paying me, and yet you want to plaster my name all over it. So that's he was the one who insisted on the question mark until the very end.
Which I think was very clever. I remember being creeped out by the mask and not knowing who it was. And
Yep.
Yeah. Blaze was Mirner Fahey.
That's it. I couldn't think of the name for a moment there.
Since you've been bringing up the parallels between this fourth appearance of the Riddler with his first, I was noticing that the episode was directed by Charles R. Rondeau, who had previously done the King Tut episode 2 weeks earlier. So clearly he must have impressed Dozier enough to be immediately re-signed to, you know, shoot another episode that quickly. And I'm wondering again if he also had the pilot as his visual template, even though the pacing was vastly different.
Very likely that could be the situation. Again, he may not have had much to go on. I can't remember, because that's the thing. The Tut episode, I remember, because we've talked about set design and scope. And the Tut episode had a lot more breath to it. I mean, because there was all those scenes out in the park. Even King Tut's truck, in which he's, you know, laying out his declarations through the golden statue he's got in the park, the interior of the truck was bigger on the inside.
Ah.
You know, so...
Good point.
You know, it's kind of odd that this director... But then again, that may not have been his choice. Like you say, we're also getting to the end of the season. Budgets are getting smaller. We've spent our money here. So he may have had to work with these smaller sets. Let me ask you, Bat Gadget, did you have a favorite in this episode?
Yeah, I always was amused by the idea of the aerosol spray cans to put you asleep and awake. So that's my vote.
All right. I would go, well, like I mentioned it before, I would go with the Bat Key.
It is the most unique one.
Yes. But I just like the idea. And to me, I don't understand why, because he's a duly deputized officer of the law. It makes sense that he could have a key that lets him into, you know, most any building in Gotham City. Why it never came up again.
Storytelling, they moved on. They came up with other gadgets. The utility belt can only hold so much. I don't know.
All right. You are Robin the Boy Wonder. You've just watched this episode with Batman, and you turn to him and you exclaim, "Holy superlative." In one word or phrase, in Robin's case, you know, how would you sum up this episode and why?
Holy slapstick, Batman. Slapstick because there was all that funny stuff in the very opening of the episode that sets the mood. And then, you know, just the silliness of the batarang and the teeth. Just, you know, that's just a crazy visual.
It's a crazy visual. And, you know, when you look at, I'm still trying to figure out how they manage. I guess that's the camera tilting down, like, you know, showing the one of him, the full blown scene where he's coming up the building, the side of the building. That was probably a dummy. That was, you know, obviously. But the shot of Burt Ward with the batarang in his mouth, I'm assuming that was just the camera tilting down, but giving it the appearance that he was going up.
Yes, which after all they perfected for the wall, the building climbing scenes. But yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. I would say holy mustached villain Batman. I always like that scene with the Riddler with the cat and the mustache on, and he's just loving taunting Batman as Batman's inching towards him. And, you know, he's got Robin there and he's like, well, you got to figure out what you're going to do next. As a kid, this episode worked for me, as I could appreciate even then. And I mentioned this before, silent films. They were still playing on television. These days, I have to wonder, though, if this were, you know, or as you know, parents show the DVDs when they finally come out to their kids, if this one's going to lose the kids, though, a little bit in the viewing.
Very well could be. Although then again, as I say, you know, you don't need to know the silent films to understand the visual comedy.
That's true. Yeah.
So, you know, I'll tell you one thing I haven't mentioned about Gorshin. As he got on in years, he stopped performing a lot, but he did the occasional convention appearance. And I was once in a green room with him at one of the New York shows just before he passed away. So, you know, he wasn't at his best. And clearly he didn't want to be there. You know, I think he was doing it because he needed the money or somebody, you know, coaxed him or whatever. So we're sitting in the room and I, you know, because I had such an affection for him as the Riddler and a respect for him as an entertainer and performer, I didn't want to ask about Batman. I didn't want to ask about the Riddler. Instead, I wanted to bring up the show he did after that for ABC, a short-lived thing called The Copycats with him and all the other impersonators. So I asked about that and I got like, you know, one or two line answer and he clearly didn't want to talk, which was disappointing. But, you know, I figured I had to say something to him. I knew I was not going to get many other opportunities, which proved to be the case. But boy, you know, you remember him as the Riddler, but when you see him do impressions in other comedy bits, I mean, that's something ABC aired and I wouldn't mind seeing on tape again. It was such fun watching these guys impersonate all these other celebrities in situations you'd never see the real people in.
You mentioned, it's funny you mentioned that because I did post a couple of weeks ago and I'll put that also in the show notes. It was Gorshin. I don't remember what show it was on, but he was doing impressions of other actors if they were Batman. So you had Burt Lancaster.
Oh, really?
Burt Lancaster as Batman and Marlon Brando as Batman with Rod Steiger as Robin.
Okay, that's funny.
Yeah. Yeah, it was pretty hysterical. I put it up on the Facebook page. I'll put it in the notes, you know, when we release this episode so you can take a look at that there for those of you listening. Oh, yeah, it was hysterical. He was something. And he also, I didn't realize this until the last Riddler episode I did. Andy Leyland brought it up. He also had, you know, released some albums, including one called The Riddler.
That's right.
Yeah.
And it Good
was actually,
point.
It was actually kind of catchy, the song.
I'm sure I heard it once upon a time. It's been a while.
Well, if you listen to, you know, the last Riddler, I put a little sample of it in the episode, the last Riddler episode we did. So,
cool. I will track that down.
So, I mean, we would say this is, you know, not a bad episode. It has its moments where it's a little, you know, weak, and certainly it loses steam though about, you know, halfway into the second episode when we get to the whole Batcave scene.
Yes, it does.
Yeah. All right, but still overall, for Frank Gorshin's last outing for now, it's not bad. So, Bob, as we come to the end of this episode here, how can people keep up with you on the internet, you know, through Facebook, or do you have a web page? I know you have your blog. Let people know, and we'll definitely put these up in the show notes as well, but let them know here how they can follow along with what you're doing in your writings. Are you contributing to the next Gotham City 14 Miles?
We just got the notes on that this week telling us the kinds of things they were looking for. I'm mentally working up a pitch now. I very much would love to be a part of the second one because the first one was so much fun.
It was. It was a great book.
As far as finding me, yes. www.bobgreenberger.com is my blog and website, and you can find appearances and bibliographies, and you can find all the stuff I write. I'm also a part of crazy8press.com, which is the digital publishing hub that Peter David, Mike Friedman, Aaron Rosenberg, Glenn Hellman, Paul Kupperberg, Russ Colchimero, and I are part of. I'm on Facebook, tweet, Bob Greenberger. I get around.
And you do all this while you're teaching?
I do all this while I'm teaching.
So you're teaching high school English?
Yes, 9th and 11th.
Wow. I remember now.
Yeah, I just got word I'll be teaching at least one, if not two, sections of creative writing the next school year, which is going to be very exciting.
Oh, that'll be cool. Very nice. Very nice.
Yeah. My department chair is so thrilled to have a published author on staff at the moment that she's trying to, you know, pimp me out.
Yeah, that's kind of what happened with me now. With you know, I'm teaching two sections of media this year.
Makes sense.
Yeah. So they specifically asking me to, you know, with an eye towards having them produce podcasts and publish blogs. So.
Right. And in my case, I'm going to be turning the creative writing course and actually trying to do either like an ebook or an e-magazine with the stories that my kids write.
Very cool. That sounds like a lot of fun.
Let's also teach him the digital skills, because after all, that's the world we live in.
That's the world we live in. Exactly. Exactly. So that's going to do it then for this episode of the Batcave Podcast. Tune in next time. It's the final episode of the first season.
Next week, the Penguin waddles again.
We're bringing in a new co-host. Joining me is an old friend of mine from my days back in the Chronic Rift Public Access show, Mr. Mike Fischera. And hopefully he'll share with us his story of how he dressed up as Batman during the premiere of the Michael Keaton movie. And sort of shocked the audience.
Holy impersonators, John.
I got to get that out of him, that story, because it's well worth telling. So until next time, citizens, thanks for listening. Bob, thank you so much for being here.
This was a pleasure, John. Thanks for inviting me.
All right. Take care, chums. See you soon. Thanks for listening, chums. I don't have a bat phone, but you can contact the Batcave Podcast through its Facebook page, Twitter, email at thebatcavepodcast@gmail.com, or by phone at 888-866-9010. Subscribe to the podcast via libsyn.com, that's libsyn.com, or through iTunes. The Batcave Podcast is part of a series of pop culture podcasts from the Chronic Rift Network. Find them at chronicrift.com. So until next time, citizens, same bat time, same Batcave Podcast.